Well, my conversation today is with New York Times bestselling author Shannon Hale and LeUyen Pham, an author and illustrator, who have a series of bestselling graphic novel memoirs, Real Friends, Best Friends, and the third in the trilogy, Friends Forever, Eighth Grade, It's Complicated. And Eighth Grade was complicated. Why is that?
Oh, there's so much going on in an eighth grader's life. When you're around that age, age 13, the human brain goes through as much changes in development as they do when they are toddlers. It's a huge leap forward. Suddenly they notice things more, they feel things more. They have this adult brain, but all of a sudden and without adult perspective, it's overwhelming, and they deserve so much love and compassion for what they're going through.
And not to mention, eighth grade year is just a crazy year, because it's the first year in school where you're introduced to sort of social customs, like dances and, you know, getting your picture taken, getting perms, like the way you look becomes very important. You girls switch over to glasses, or from glasses to contacts very often.
Yeah.
You're getting your grown-up body, but you're not an adult.
Right. I remember it. I remember just feeling so awkward. It was like, I mean, I felt I was bullied in elementary school. So that was bad. I had friends, you know, obviously, but I was also really picked on a lot because I was different. Right. And so reading this book, oh my gosh, like this book really hit home on so many different levels. I even think like a 13-year-old could read this and say, like, you know, like be able to identify with one of those characters.
Yeah. Actually, I think 13-year-olds read these books very different than we do as adults.
Right.
As adults, we're looking back through the lens of perspective. We've put some distance. We remember them as really hard years. A 13-year-old is going through it. They don't realize that this is going to be one of the hardest years of their lives.
Right. That's the thing. There's no perspective, you know. Tell me about your first two books before we get to the third book. Shannon authored it, and LeUyen, you did all the illustrations in it. How did that even come to be? How did your partnership come to be?
Well, we were friends for many years, and then we started to work together on a different series of books called The Princess in Black that I wrote with my husband and Wynn illustrated. Those are early chapter books. And Wynn is a premier children's book illustrator. She's illustrated over 120 picture books. She's a master in
I'm
her
paying
field.
Her to say that.
She truly is. She's the most exquisite, talented illustrator alive today. And so, of course, I would always want to work with her. But I started writing a manuscript for a graphic novel that's a memoir of my childhood friendships, my elementary school friendships, and it's called Real Friends. And I sent it to her just to get her perspective as an illustrator, because I didn't think she would want, graphic novels are a tremendous amount of work for an illustrator.
Yes.
And I truly didn't think that she would want to do it. And then she read the script.
I got the script, and I gotta say, it was one of those things. Normally when you read a graphic novel script, you don't get sucked into it the way you do a regular novel.
Right. It's like reading a screenplay. It's like a regular narrative.
Yeah, but there was something in Shannon's writing, even in just the dialogue, not even the descriptions, but just the dialogue, in which you really felt connected to that character. I immediately knew who little Shannon was. And the same way that you're talking about, Kim, how you were saying, you know, you read the book and you connected with it. You would have connected it with it at the manuscript level as well.
Well, that's the thing, is that I felt when I was reading it, there's something, I'm sure it's beautiful as a manuscript, okay? But there's something about those illustrations that disarm you. It's different when you read the words, and there's something that makes you feel warm. As like you can really identify with a character, you know, and when you sometimes just have words, because I'm a writer, you know, so when you have words, it's great, because the person has to kind of imagine the image all in their head all by themselves. But when you have something like this, it's weird. It was like a third person experience. That's why I think this would be such a great book to be able to get into the hands, you know, of young people. Now, I interviewed you for Outside Inside, right?
Yes, you did.
And those illustrations were completely different. Just to give you an idea, like, okay.
This is what I'm saying, Kim. She is so talented. You know, most artists, so hard that most artists specialize in one certain form. you can't recognize her between different books.
That's the point.
Welcome to the LeUyen Pham Show.
Oh my gosh. I just want to sing her praises.
And that's the point. That's exactly the point. What age group would you say this is for?
10 to 14 is what the publishers say.
No.
The great thing
any
about
age group, any age group.
That's the thing about graphic novels. The wisdom used to be that kids don't want to read about characters younger than them. So yeah. If the character's 13, then a 14-year-old won't read it. But with graphic novels, they're so accessible that older kids will read books about younger people because they like to look back and process what they went through when they were younger. Right. And younger kids will read beyond their grade level of reading because the pictures kind of hold their hand through it. And then adults, something like this, like you were saying, Kim, how your response to it, it's really great for adults to read these books.
That's
to
remember
what it was felt like. And that really gives them more empathy for kids going through it now and more understanding what their kids are going through.
You're saying what it was like. I read that now and I feel that way.
Right? We never leave middle school, Kim. We never escape.
You get bigger bodies. That's about it. Shannon, was this based on your life? The little girl, like I loved how you drew her with that cute little hair and face. Is that you? Yeah. And did you live that life?
Yeah, these are memoirs.
Yeah, I got to draw Shannon as a little girl. But you know, to be fair, take away the freckles and make the hair black and you know the eyes brown and darker skin, and you got me.
That's it.
I'm telling you.
Oh, I love it. Shannon, what was it like for you to that first time to see your work played out in animation?
It was crazy. It was insane. It's honestly one of the most loving gifts I have ever received. And I know Wynn didn't just do it for me. That would be insane. And this was, you know, a part of our business. But for somebody, I'm going to get emotional, Kim.
Yeah.
I can't help it. But
I get it.
For somebody to take you at your most vulnerable and insecure and lovingly draw picture after picture of that in a compassionate way, it was incredibly moving and healing for me. And I would say even like in Best Friends, the second book, throughout the book, I had inserted pieces from the novel, the fantasy novel I was writing at the time. And we include sequences of the fantasy novel verbatim from my manuscript, my sixth grade.
Oh, wow.
And Wynn painted these in her, she's this the most amazing artist, and she beautifully painted images of this little story I was writing when I was 12. I mean, that blew my mind. My younger self would have freaked out. I just love her so much.
I get it. That's what I'm saying. It was the perfect marriage. Like I started reading, I was going to just read a little bit. I started reading and I'm reading and reading and reading. And the drawings, the animation, it does pull you in. And so like didn't you Shannon have a book that was adapted to film? Cause I could see this being adapted to film.
I did. One of my books for adults called Austinland, we made into a movie.
Wow.
I think it would be hard to have this be a film though, because it's a true story. And when you sign over film rights, they get to control it at that point.
Yeah.
So it's like signing over myself to somebody to tell my story without, you know, at that point, no longer my permission, no longer my approval. That would be a little
Kim, scary. Keep it down. We're going to keep it in the graphic novel format. That's the best place for it. Okay?
I don't know.
You want to know Shannon,
maybe y'all could consult on like a Saturday morning show, like a cartoon for kids to watch where you're exposed to all this. So when it actually happens to you, you're like, yeah, I know how that turns out. It all turns out, you know what I mean? It all turns out fine. I love this. A reviewer said reading this book is like getting a hug from a friend. That had to have like just.
that was the best review.
That was the best review. And we both went kind of melted when we read it. Because it was, you try not to care about reviews, but you do. Because it means a lot to be validated by people who have devoted their lives to loving and appreciating books.
Right.
These reviewers really care about books. And when someone like that,
they get it
and they feel what you were trying to do. Yeah, that was tremendous.
And it's crazy because Shannon goes around saying that books are like hugs, that you're trying to reach out and connect with people through those words, and to have a reviewer say that. gosh, it just felt like people understood. So, and
LeUyen, when you illustrate this, where do you even begin? Like, and is it, it's computer and like, how do you start? Because the characters, you can feel the characters. So it's not just some drawing. Like, how do you do it?
This is the first technical question I've gotten.
I know,
You know, I'm going to be honest. I start first with all my conversations with Shannon and a lot of stuff that we're talking about. She's not even necessarily talking about the books. I'm just talking with her and realizing how she feels about certain things.
Getting the feeling for it.
Getting the emotions, getting the understanding where you want that sympathy level to be. That's where I start. And then it turns into sketches really quickly. The first couple of books I actually did on paper and pencil.
That's what I was wondering as well.
Yeah, this one was the first book I did digitally. And I think it's because it was done during the COVID year.
Mm.
And this is really interesting. It takes place in eighth grade. Both of our kids went through their eighth grade year in lockdown.
Oh,
and
wow.
I'm drawing this book during my son's lockdown year. He was experiencing eighth grade through my drawings, which I found crazy.
Yeah.
And there's something where I think if I kept it digital, he could actually give me a lot of input and ask questions, and I could clarify for him, this is what a school dance is like. This is what a school debate is like. And it both breaks my heart and it warms me to know that I was so integral in that part of his growing up.
Thank goodness. It was like a gift. It was like a gift for you to give to him. I mean, you know, do you ever feel like this stuff just comes down? I've interviewed other writers who said they feel like it just comes down and they grab the magic.
This was a lot of work.
She didn't grab anything. She dragged it towards
her. There was no muse that like just sort of dumped it into my head. Yeah. Memoirs are incredibly challenging for someone who writes a lot of fiction. I know some people have assumed that it must be easier to write memoir than fiction because you already know what happens.
Yeah.
But exactly the opposite. I have an excellent imagination. I have no trouble making up stuff to happen. But when something wasn't working in the book, I was like, I can't just make something up.
Right.
I have to write exactly what happened. So it's a great deal of massaging, moving things around, moving pieces around, figuring out different ways to tell what's happening. So you're communicating the emotion and making the story flow without having to make up, because I can't make up facts.
Go ahead.
Sorry. I remember one of the first books, there was something that Shannon does that's not very kind in the book.
Oh, yeah.
And my son, who of course proofreads everything, he was reading it through and he was kind of crying at that point. Oh. And he said, Mama, can't you just change this part of the story? Does Shannon have to be this mean? And I had to look at him and say, no, you can't change what actually happened.
Right, That is pretty funny. I'd be asking that same question. Can I change this little part? But you know, that's the thing is you show in the book that as it goes on, things work together. You have your own tribe. You have your own friends that are there for you. Was it therapeutic writing the book?
It was really therapeutic. One thing I really believe, and I know some therapists work with this method, is that you can change the past by rethinking it, retooling it, imagining it in a different way.
Yeah.
When you trauma in the past, when some therapy, if you reimagine it, go through it, imagine it over and over again the way it was, and then change details to make it more gentle for yourself.
Yeah.
And the trauma goes away and you're actually like rewiring your brain. So the process of writing this out was incredibly therapeutic. And then we ended in a way, to me, it feels like me, myself now, got to go back in time and give my younger self a hug and let her know you're doing okay. It's hard, but you're doing okay and you're going to be okay.
Oh, I love that. Have you heard from any love connection. Have you heard from any of your former classmates?
You know,
we were just doing that.
We were just actually like Googling face. Like, what do they look like now? I totally understand why people want to know about the people in the books. Like, what do they think and where are they now? And none of these people wanted to be or asked to be written into a book. So I decided with the first book, I was like, I'm never going to talk about these people outside of the context of the book. Because when I'm writing, I'm very careful about how I portray them. I'm very thoughtful. And so I don't want to say anything afterwards. Well, you know, and some people have read it. Some people haven't. I don't know if some have, but Yeah, I want to give them some privacy.
Fair enough. How about you, LeUyen? Have you heard from any of your former friends?
Oh, no. But you know what? I think people always, I had a friend, I remember, who was sort of a bit of a bully to me. And she actually did read the first book. She knew that it wasn't supposed to be about her, but she did reach out to me afterwards and said, you know, I remember treating you not well as well. And I remember just feeling so warm about that, that she saw one of my books and realized and came sort of full circle. So it's weird. Like
When I was on the air, when I was many years ago, when I was working in Grand Rapids, and I also heard from like one of the biggest bullies that ever bullied me and called me on the request line and also owned up to it. And I said, like, you don't know how much this means, like all these years later. And she said, you know, and this is no excuse, but the life that I was living at the time, you know, and learning about what she was going through, like I can understand, like coming to school, you just want to I guess when you're a kid, you don't know how to get that stuff out. Like you don't know how to constructively get it out. It's probably a better way to say it.
And you know, when I'm writing these books, even when I'm illustrating people who were genuinely awful to me or other people, I don't ever, and I think maybe it comes through us, but with what we write and how when illustrates, we not want to demonize anyone.
Right.
We feel compassion.
Yes.
We wish they hadn't behaved that way. Right. And I would hope I wouldn't behave that way, but we do feel compassion for where they are. They're all going through a lot, all of them. And there's so much we don't know about what everybody else is going through.
Yeah. That's
it. The nice thing too is like the story never ends. It just keeps going. And that's what's lovely about this.
Yeah. That's the beauty of it all. And Shannon, I was skimming somewhere and you said that, did you say something like about OCD that played in to some of the insecurities, was it, or what?
Yeah. So I grew up with an undiagnosed anxiety disorder and obsessive compulsive disorder. I didn't know those words at the time. I was never talked to about it. I didn't know people who talked about it. Mental health really wasn't discussed in the 1980s. But the effort, so with Friends Forever, when it takes place in eighth grade, the reason why I wanted to do eighth grade in part was because that's when I really imploded. The effort of trying to hold in all those feelings for so many years, trying to be the person I thought people wanted me to be, trying to hide all the negative emotions I was feeling because I felt ashamed for feeling them. I didn't know a good reason why I should be feeling them. People would say, why can't you just be happy? Why can't you just be okay? I don't know. I'm trying. And then I imploded into depression.
And you learned that diagnosis at what age?
I did go to a psychiatrist. My mom took me to a psychiatrist in eighth grade, but I kind of faked my way through it because I didn't know anyone who was a psychiatrist. That was a scary new thing.
Not in the 80s.
No. And so I kind of faked my, without really lying, because I was not ever a good liar. I just only tried to portray myself and everything in the situation in the best light. Like, oh, my mom's just worried about me because my grades are dropping. I didn't put it in the context of I'd been a straight A student my entire life and now I'm failing half my classes and I can't get out of bed and I want to die all the time. You know, I didn't tell all the truth. I only told part of the truth to get out of it. But then I was left without anyone there to help me. And it really, I kind of had to claw my own way out, really. And it was only as an adult looking back, especially as I learned more about OCD as an adult, because I had family members with OCD, that I went, oh my gosh, that's what was going on. Holy cow. My particular, there's OCD manifests a lot of ways. And with me, one of the main ways it manifested was scrupulosity, which was very confusing for a kid growing up in a religious household to be told, listen for that still small voice of the spirit that will tell you truth and direct you what to do. And the little voice inside me was telling me, your mom's going to die. Your mom's going to die. Right. And if you don't do certain things, she will be dead and it will be your fault. And you are bad. You are bad. And here's every bad thing you did. You need to repent constantly all the time or God will not love you. And that was not God or the spirit. That was OCD. Yeah. And it would have been really helpful to know that.
Right. Yeah. And you're right. As a kid, I mean, who can't relate to that at some point? You know, with the pressures that are, especially now, that are put on kids, I would think that that would even be diagnosed even more. I'll tell you, when I read the book, The Santa Story, the disgusting Santa story,
We haven't talked about that yet.
No.
Yeah. And it goes back to the illustrations, LeUyen and Shannon, is that reading that story makes it more real and it makes it more palatable because of the illustration. Again, it feels like you're looking,
two panels, and we spent more time on that probably than
I think it's the one else. I think it's the one portion of the book that I got the most feedback from both you and our editor Connie, because I
what was that
to show
Connie, our editor. Yeah, so just the basic of the story. When I was 13, I was at a Christmas tree festival. My friend and I thought it would be funny to sit on the Santa's lap, because we were too old and we were being very silly. Right. And he asked me, I didn't ask you what you want for Christmas as we were getting up to leave. And I said, I want you, Santa. I didn't even know what that meant.
Throw away.
And he grabbed my butt and said, you don't know how much I want you. Mm. And my editor and I went back and forth as we're doing the script, trying to figure out how to show that, how to tell that story, because it's something that a lot of kids face.
Yes.
And we wanted to be very careful about how we talked about that, to communicate it. It's a very fine line. And so it was, so much of that was on when and how to illustrate that.
In terms of the illustration, I mean, when you draw Santa Claus, he's a very jovial character traditionally. Mm-hmm. And it's really hard to draw that side of a Santa that when you first look at it, you don't think he's a swarmy kid in a costume, you know, about to make moves on a little girl. You're just thinking it's supposed to be Santa Claus. And so there were things where you had to suggest, okay, you got to make it really clear that it's a fake beard that's right on
you. She's got a panel where you can see like the mustache is kind of falling off.
I know.
The shadow. This is not really perfect. Santa. This is a fake dude.
But I think the hardest part was the actual, when he touches her, I went back and forth trying to figure out, just as a mother, I could not bring myself to draw that image probably the way it happened. And I sort of compromised by cropping a little bit of it out so that the suggestion is all in her face and sort of his posture. It was just enough so that the reader knew what was happening without having to see it. And that
it was a perfect amount to make you feel sick to your stomach. It was a perfect amount to like look at and understand exactly what was happening. Like you captured the face, the posture, it goes back to your, about the feeling. So I'm with Shannon on this. I think you're the best. Just accept it.
Thank you. Thank you, Kim.
Coming on the show every week.
Please join the LeUyen Pham Club with me. I'm president. And
this book is going to help so many middle schoolers try to navigate the world. And I just hope that everybody buys it. It's called, first of all, let me tell you who you're talking to here. New York Times bestselling author, Shannon Hale, LeUyen Pham, an author and illustrator. They have that series of bestselling graphic novels we talked about earlier, their memoirs, Real Friends, Best Friends, and the third in the trilogy, Friends Forever, Eighth Grade. It's complicated. So, well, where can people reach out to you?
We both have websites, shannonhale.com,
leuyenpham.com. It's leuyenpham as in Mary.com.
And I'm on Twitter at Hale Shannon, and I'm going to try and be better at Instagram.
And I'm on Instagram at win, loser, draw, but win is spelled UYEN. So I'm teaching you all how to pronounce win in Vietnamese.
I love it. I love it. Hey, thanks so much for talking with me. Come back when you have your new series going. Okay.
Thank you, Kim.
You asked amazing questions. Thanks so much.
It's fun. It's so fun talking to you and learning. So take care. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.